We have with us from Funeralocity, the CEO, Ed Michael Reggie, and Vice President, Chief Strategy Officer, Gene Schwartz. Welcome to you both.
Thank you.
I got to know, what'd you learn in that last segment, Michael?
I learned a lot. A lot of things I identify with, how to manage growth, how to find the right people.
You probably had never had a business failure before, though, have you? Or have you stumbled a couple times in your day?
There are daily stumbles when you're in the startup
right?
world.
Yeah.
So now, can you talk about how Funeralocity came about?
Yes. I guess about 2 years ago, I was giving a reunion of a company that I had started and sold 10 years before that. And that company had about 100 employees, and it was in New Orleans. And so I booked a bar in New Orleans, the way you do these kind of things,
right.
And had employees come. And one of the first people to come in, she came right up to me, and a former employee, and she said, "I just came from a funeral." And it was the worst process, the worst experience. You guys ought to look at doing something about that. And
why would she think you?
My
knew
company
how to
is my company is called Future Factory.
Okay.
And we have launched startups and run startups for years.
Mm-hmm.
So we've been in software and in healthcare and in beverages and restaurants, and we have some investments here in Atlanta. And so I went to my chief technology officer, and the next day we started a deep dive into the world of funerals, mm-hmm. which we never thought we would be in.
Wow.
So what'd you learn?
I learned that it's a perceived to be opaque business that consumers, the average consumer does plans 1.5 funerals in their lifetime. So basically they're a rookie the first time, the only time they do it. They don't
right.
know what they're doing. It's a huge business, $21 billion industry in the United States. But people don't know how to compare, how to rank. They don't know what the prices are. They're lost.
Are each of the funeral homes, are they family owned, or is this owned by some mega conglomerate?
86% of the funeral homes in America are family owned, mom and pop owned. 14% are corporate chains, publicly traded.
And are they aggressively buying up these family owned?
There have been ebbs and flows in that. In the 90s, there were major acquisitions, and then some of these roll-ups got in trouble and had a shed. And now it's a slow growth by these big companies. So there's not a great deal of acquiring of mom and pops right now.
Now, are funerals a thing that people are going to keep doing, or is this going to be obsolete at some point?
It's a good question. It depends what we mean by funeral.
Mm-hmm.
Cremation, in 2016, 50% of American funerals were cremation.
And is that high or low?
Very high. It has historically been rising every year.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of projections show in 10 years, it'll be 60% or 70%. It's moving in that direction. If you use California as a benchmark, California is already at 70 or 80% cremation.
Wow. Is it because they don't have the space?
Different reasons. Space is an issue. There's a perception that it's greener to cremate. And also, people aren't living often where their families were.
Right. That's why
and I thought the family plot concept is increasingly obsolete with the mobile
right.
society.
That's what I would, especially for younger people that are online constantly, why would they want, I can't even picture them going somewhere annually to go and spend time at the gravesite of a loved one, where everybody's spread out around the world nowadays.
There are amazing statistics on how few times people visit the gravesite of their antecedents, once or twice in a lifetime. Doesn't happen very much.
Right. So to invest all that money, especially when the person's not around anymore, it's harder to justify, I would imagine.
Yes. But of course, there are religious considerations. There are other cultural aspects that have to be considered in why a family does bury or does cremate.
Now, when they choose to, this is where you guys come in, right? Can you explain your service?
Yes, funeralocity.com. We have built, and we are launching in Atlanta, a national company, but we are completely concentrating on Atlanta right now.
Mm-hmm.
You go in to the website, and put in your address or zip code, and you get all of the funeral homes in Atlanta by geography, or you can look by cremation, and all of the prices of all the funeral homes are there.
So you were able to get all that pricing? Because isn't it, you said it was opaque, kind of, it's not out there in a public manner, is it, the pricing?
Yes, right. I said perceived opaque because indeed there is a federal law that's been books for 20 years that says, it's called the funeral rule, enforced by the FTC, that requires funeral homes to give their prices to anyone who calls.
Okay. And so you were able to leverage that in order to get all the pricing.
That's right. So we've done that. We've put all the pricing online. But, you know, it's not about price only at all. Mm-hmm. The story of the internet, of internet commerce, is value competition. It's not, I mean, you know, people go to Expedia and they book Motel 6 or they book Ritz-Carlton.
Sure.
Depending on what their mm-hmm. needs are.
Right.
And it's the same thing here. So that's why we also are populating the site with videos, profile information, ratings, reviews, all of that. And you know, the story of the internet is very much ratings and reviews.
Absolutely.
We've seen the ebbing of some brands because of the internet. And one of the ones I think about when I see your Vizio television screen right there, when I was growing up, Sony was the preeminent brand.
Right.
The Trinitron. Do you remember that?
Absolutely.
that was the premium brand to own. Redefined by ratings and price, Vizio, go on Amazon, 5 stars, $699, big screen.
Right.
Sony can't hold a candle, and its market share is just not there anymore. And more, the way a business puts itself forth on the internet is the most important branding that it can do. It has to put the value proposition. So we believe that we are bringing funeral service into the 21st century, where there's a third-party website like Expedia, like TripAdvisor, like so many others, that people can look on one place and look at price, look at ratings, and make a value decision about which funeral home they want to talk to.
I'm still at the bar. You're very articulate. And this all makes a lot of sense in the context of this conversation. And I'm trying to envision the conversation at the bar, or you go back to your colleagues or partners and you're saying, you don't think we'll get in the funeral business?
I went up to my chief technology officer at the bar that night and I said, dude, one word. And he looked at me, I said, funerals. And I swear, he looked at me and he went, funerals.
Exactly. Awesome.
And we just decided to start looking into it. We have always looked for interesting startups. And we just dove into it and kept finding more and more information that made us encouraged that we wanted to go into this space, that we could really do something good, not just for consumers, but also for funeral homes.
And then how'd you pick Atlanta?
Atlanta, I know well. I lived here in the right after the Olympics till the early 2000s. I have investments in restaurants here, the Fifth Group restaurants. If you know South City Kitchen,
absolutely.
Those guys,
yeah.
I've been with those guys a long time. I've invested in book publishing here, and I know Atlanta very well, but there's, of course, much more important reasons, and that is we all know Atlanta is the business center of the Southeast.
There you go.
It is business
good
progressive.
Kissing app.
No, but it is. It is. Listen, I grew up in New Orleans. You know, we all look to Atlanta. Atlanta's the business capital of the South. But also, very important for us, 50% of the 6 million people who live in Atlanta, 50% of them weren't even born in Georgia.
Right.
Why is that important? Because the Smiths, who buried the Jones for 3 generations, that doesn't happen here. Many people live in Sandy Springs, Georgia, who didn't grow up here, and they don't have a funeral home.
Right.
So rather than go to mainline Philadelphia, where a huge percentage of people are still there who grew up there, who have established funeral home relationships, we believe that the Amazon.com, Amazon shopper will Google and say, funeral home, I need one. I'm looking for cremation. I'm looking for something.
Right.
So we think Atlanta is prime for that because of so many people not being from here.
Now, when you do your research and find these kind of transient cities, where are people, like, I'm not from here. I was born in New York, raised in Miami, Florida. My family lives in Florida, by and large. When I die, what typically happens? Do my people put me here in Atlanta? What occurs?
There's a small percentage of bodies get shipped back to home for the family plot.
Right.
But that's decreasing. And I think these are all the reasons why cremation
is
happening.
I'm asking because I don't know. I never thought about it before.
Yeah. So I had never really thought about it before either.
So it's typically the when you get buried where you're, wherever you die?
Well, yes. It's much more often the case than being shipped back home.
Mm-hmm. Or you get cremated and then you're not actually in a plot.
That's right. You can be in a plot. You can be in a columbarium, which is a like a mausoleum for urns. You could be buried. You could be spread. Ashes
or
spread.
I'll just like pay GoDaddy to keep my website going. So they can always find me.
That's right.
Let's just Google me. So now what's next for you guys? What do you need more of?
We want to make sure Atlanta, this launch continues the momentum that it has right now to be spectacular. Mm-hmm. We really want this to be the demonstration to the rest of the country. We've already begun recruiting funeral homes into this effort in other parts of the country. We want to go national as soon as we can.
And then for you, it's you're providing the service to the consumer, but it'll be funded by the funeral homes paying for more enhanced listings?
Correct. For a more enhanced presence, we created an excellence program where we insist that funeral homes live up to certain standards.
Right, like a certification
and, yes. And to be part of that, they need to they have the opportunity though to enrich their site on our site with more videos and giving a lot more information to the consumer, and at the same time also paying a fee to us.
And then is it going to be like a Yelp or something where people can put individual reviews as well?
You bet. They will be able to give reviews because that's very much part of the lifeblood of what makes e-commerce happen. I want to distinguish that this is a shopping exercise as opposed to a buying exercise. 90% of the home purchases today begin online as shopped. We all know you take the virtual tours, go to Zillow, but you buy it in a different venue. 84% of the automobile sales begin online but get closed. Funerals are not like booking the Motel 6 or the Ritz-Carlton.
Right.
You've got to plan it. You've got to know how many people. You need an expert. So what this gives you is the ratings, the prices, and then you connect. And Funeralocity connects families to the funeral home they want to speak to after looking at everything.
Now, for you, you mentioned that this is just one thing in your portfolio. Is there anything else you got on your radar coming up?
No, we also run a clinical drug trials company that runs trials all across the country. It's 8 years old now. We've got a great CEO, and they're blowing and going and doing a lot of great things. But nothing on the horizon for me but this.
This is it.
This is too much fun. This is too exciting, and we have a long way to go with this.
If you ever need a chief technical officer, I know a guy. You know, if you need some help in that area, software expansion. You.
Is he in the room?
I can't say. Okay. I can't confirm or deny that. But so if somebody wanted to learn more, the website?
Funeralocity.com.
So it's a word funeral and then ocity.
That's right.
.com.
That's right.
All right. But I want to hear a little bit from Gene before we wrap. Just the day-to-day, how the site works, speaking to a lay person, can you just walk us through that a little bit?
Sure. It's very, very simple. It's a transactional basic website that has one purpose, which is you go on there to find a funeral home. So as Ed Michael mentioned, you put in your address or your zip code and you'll get a list of search results. And you can look through them and say, that one looks interesting, and click on it and go to a profile page where you can see those videos and photos and read testimonials and read ratings and reviews. And when you decide that funeral home looks like one that you'd like to connect with, you simply click. And we get the funeral home in contact with the family right away. It can be the middle of the night, doesn't matter. They will get a call right away. And then they will get turned over to the funeral director because, as Ed Michael said, that you need an expert and you need someone to help you plan and decide what you want. You know, we joke all the time about people going onto car lots thinking they want an F-150 and you know, you come out with an SUV. It's not, you know, you don't know. You may think you know, but because it is...
You're a rookie, like he was saying, right?
Yes, that's exactly right. It says people, you know, it's like picking a spouse, right? 1.5 times in your lifetime as well.
So the funeral directors, these organizations, are they embracing this idea, this concept? Is this a hard I don't know if sell is the right word, but is it a hard conversation to have, or they're embracing
this? It's not. It's a great new channel for them. And they are continuing to do everything that they previously did, but this is getting them the people who are the Amazon.com shoppers, people who will go online and want to go online, and that's where they spend their time. And so in today's world, even with the funeral rule, you would have to go to one website at a time or pick up the phone and call one funeral home at a time. And when's the last time you did that? You know, when you were looking for a drill, you know,
right.
it's a very difficult process. And we conducted a Harris poll before we ventured into this and talked to over 2,000 people across the country. And 88% of Americans think that funeral prices are not transparent and want them to be more transparent. And 79% said they wanted a third-party site where they could go and compare. So you talk about solving problems. This is a huge problem that people don't even realize that they have until it happens to them. And they're at a time of worst time in their life. You know, they're grieving, they're upset, they're confused. They don't want to ask questions or know what to ask. And it's very difficult. So I think one of the good things about this is you can do it for pre-planning a funeral as well as, you know, waiting until it happens to you, because the information is all there and you can get it in the privacy of your own home, on your phone, on your tablet, on your computer. You know, you can do it at your own, in your own way.
Now, what percentage of people pre-plan?
That's a great question.
30%.
Yeah.
Really? So the vast majority don't. They just wait. It happens. And all of a sudden now they're panicked and they're kind of buying impulse.
And they're not in a great emotional state. They probably want to take all the direction they can get, right?
Right. That's right. And they feel guilty about asking anything about prices because it's your aunt, right? You feel like you're not being a good relative if you're going to be worried about anything at that point in time, except for getting things taken care of the way you want to. And funeral directors are wonderful people. I mean, when you think about the job they do, they have to take care of somebody in 3 days or less, and everything has to be perfect and everything has to work, because the worst thing in the world that can happen is something to go wrong with a loved one's funeral. And they rise to that challenge all the time. And most of them are in it because they perceive it as a calling, you know, not a career. And I think it's really important to note that.
Good stuff. And the website one more time?
Funeralocity.com.